Hey class, it's Amanda Burbage, your Humanities 246 instructor, and I wanted to provide you some information about our problem-solving alternatives. You'll see in the module that there are a lot of examples, but some of them are a little stale, or they're very math-related, and that's not everybody's cup of tea. So I wanted to walk through a few examples that weren't so math-oriented. First, let's take a look at this problem, paying for college. There's a class of 3 credits, which costs about $450 at TCC. Now, that's not necessarily the exact amount, but I'm using it for round numbers. And the payment is due on August 19th, which is when classes begin. If it's July 1st and I've got $200, and between now and the time that the due date of the payment is, I'll get another $100, what can I expect from a problem-solving process? Now, in this case, you might want to use the logical reasoning approach, and here's why. With logical reasoning, and this is kind of a math example, but it's a real-life math example, and you'll go through the steps of, okay, what do I have, what do I need, and what am I going to do to get what I need? So in this case, we'll determine the shortfall, which is about $150, because I've got two, I'm going to get another one, so that's three, and I need $450. So that's about $150 of a shortfall. And I need to think to myself, what can I do over the next 2 months to raise $150? Now, I don't care what you're gonna do to get the money. I don't care if you're gonna work extra shifts or beg for it from someone in your family, but no matter what you decide, you're gonna want to start working on the plan early enough to make sure that the plan takes place and you get your money before that tuition due date. So that logical reasoning approach to problem solving is one that's very practical and useful in real life. Let's take a look at another example. All right, so you've been dating someone for about 5 months and you're not necessarily official, but you're not necessarily totally open either. So somewhere in between. And of course, things started out really well, but now it's been 2 months and there's a longer and longer time period between text messages. This individual has even blown you off, stood you up, not shown up for meetings 3 times in a row. So let's use some pattern recognition to solving this problem. I know a lot of you know where this is going, but when you're in these shoes, it's a lot harder to do than when you're looking at it from the outside. So first we need to name the pattern. Okay, so what is the pattern? Well, whoever it is that you're kind of dating, the pattern is they're not reliable and they're not demonstrating interest. And if that hurts your feelings, I'm really sorry. You can cry about it later or write about it in your journal or talk to me. I'd love to counsel you through that. But the truth is, that's life sometimes. So now that we've named the pattern, we sometimes need to separate the person from the problem. All right, maybe this person is really good. They're really nice, whatever. You might be giving them a little too much credit, but even if they're really good and they're really nice, this relationship isn't. So it's okay to say someone's a good person, but that you and that individual, it's not a good relationship. Totally acceptable to draw that boundary. And then based on this pattern and recognizing the pattern and naming the pattern, you make a choice, which I suggest is deleting that number. Let's take a look at another example. All right, so this is the fair point. And let me add, it's been a busy week, and actually it's been a busy month. So there have been a few deadlines that were missed. You know, I have this class and this professor, so annoying, doesn't take late work, and now my grade is suffering. So I need help, but I'm uncomfortable asking for it. Now, in this case, I'm going to ask you to take an adopting a different point of view approach to the problem solving process. So when you're adopting a different point of view, basically what you're doing is you're identifying your own pattern of thinking, your own point of view. And you might think, Professor Burbage, why? I already know what I think. But I want you to kind of like say it out loud, and you don't have to do it in public, so it's okay, but really talk to yourself. So this is what I think. I think that it's been busy. I think that I haven't done what I'm supposed to do, and I know it. I know that if I don't get help, it's going to continue to go badly, and I'm probably gonna fail my classes because I don't see it turning around. All right, so that's my point of view, but let's choose a different point of view. Let's think about the other person who's involved in the scenario. So in this case, it would be the faculty member, the teacher, but it may be other people. It may be someone in your family, it may be someone at work. In this case, I'll take the role of the teacher. I feel like a natural at that. So Let's see here. What would my professor's feelings or thoughts be about this? Well, they have expectations and I haven't met their expectations, so they might be disappointed. They might be wondering what's going on with me since I haven't communicated with them at all. They might be frustrated because they want to have work turned in and they're not getting it turned in, or they might be annoyed if I even ask for help because maybe I should have asked for it earlier. Or they might be glad that I ask for help because they want me to be successful. That's a hint. So then you ask yourself, okay, so these are all the things the other person might say, might do, might think, might feel. And if I believed, like, in the best case scenario, if I believed the best in that person, how would that change the way that I feel about my problem? So in this case, I know I need help, but I'm uncomfortable asking for it. And my problem is, what should I do? So I've adopted a different point of view. I've looked at it from the point of view of the faculty member. And if I believe the best in a faculty member, they might be slightly annoyed at a late night email, but it's not going to ruin their world. And they're not teaching because they're here to get me or to punish me. They're teaching because they want me to have knowledge and they want me to be successful. Nobody goes into education to get rich. So if I believe the best in my teacher, then I might be willing to run the risk of asking for help. And let me think through what's the worst case scenario and what's the best case scenario. And that kind of relates to our next example. But before I move on, let me just remind you that you should reach out to your teacher if you're having struggles. And the final example, dun, dun, dun. I told my boss that I would finish inventory by Friday, and she's out of town, so she won't know until Monday anyway, and it's Thursday, and I'm not really feeling inventory today. And if I skip today, Friday will be ridiculously difficult. So what's the chances here? What should I do? You know, what are my odds? So let's use the extreme case approach to problem solving. Here's how we do it. First, we think about, like, what are the cases? You know, what are the end results given pattern one, pattern two, pattern three, or choice one, choice two, choice three? The first choice might be I just get over myself. I get my inventory done, whether I want to or not, and I meet my deadline, and then my boss, dot, dot, dot. I mean, probably my boss is happy, but doesn't necessarily do backflips because I'm just doing the job that I said that I would do and probably that I get paid to do. So good job, but nothing extra. If I don't do an inventory today on Thursday because I'm just not feeling it, and Friday goes badly, then I definitely won't get my inventory done. And if I don't get my inventory done, I probably won't get busted because my boss isn't coming in till Monday. Now, if that's the case, and so outcome one was I got it done, easy peasy, lemon squeezy, we're clean and clear. Case two is more like I'm not getting it done, but I'm hiding the fact from my boss so that they never know. It's like breaking something and fixing it before the individual finds out that it got broken in the first place. And so in this case, I would have to come in unpaid on a Saturday to finish my task. And then in the last case, I don't do inventory today. Friday is awful. I never get it done. I don't come in on Saturday because I have a life. And then my boss finds out I didn't get inventory done by Monday. And what might the consequence be? And in this case, it might be you get written up. It might be you lose a shift and therefore money in your pocket. It might be that you get fired. Maybe there's no consequence. I don't know. That would be kind of an interesting workplace to be in. You know, there's also the other case that I didn't write down, which is that your boss shows up early unexpectedly and catches you red-handed. So based on these cases, it's not really a clear solution, right? So I might think through my pain points. What is the pain of me today, Thursday, doing the inventory versus the pain of me coming in on Saturday? And maybe it's like, oh, Saturday, that's cool. Or what is the pain of me coming in on a Saturday versus maybe losing my job? And I think I'm gonna either try to get it done today or Saturday. All right, so problem solving in the real world is pretty fun, and there's lots of different approaches that you can take. The approach that you take matters because it will lead you to various and different solutions. So be creative in your problem solving.